Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum and Yali Mother to everybody. I'm thrilled to be with you. Thank you so much for having me today. I have to say that I've made two previous trips to Salt Lake City and to Provo. Both of them were during the winter. So I feel a little bit cheated that I don't get to see the leaves turning with all of you at the beginning of an academic year. God willing, one day soon that will happen. I want to tell you how much I admire BYU as an institution, how much I admire the community that is the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I grew up with members of the LDS community. In fact, I had one of my closest friends and my girlfriend for a time in high school was a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. In so many ways, the depth of my respect for religious commitment as a whole and my interest in religious diversity begins with those friendships. So thank you so much for welcoming me in your midst, at least virtually, and I look forward to this time with you. So if we could go to my first slide, I want to tell you about a Kairos moment in my life, a supreme moment in my life. I was in South Africa in December of 1999, and I saw maybe the greatest figure of the 20th century, this man, Nelson Mandela, speak. And the first thing that he did was he pointed his finger out into the Cape towards Robben Island, where he had spent some 27 years of his life as a prisoner of the apartheid regime. And he said, I would still be there in that prison on that island if it had not been for the Christians and the Muslims, the Jews and the Hindus, the Baha'is and the Buddhists and the Quakers, the secular humanists, the members of indigenous traditions, and I imagine some members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints as well. If it had not been for them coming together in a movement called the Struggle Against Apartheid. And he went on to discuss just how important diverse faith communities coming together were in bringing down an evil system that dramatically oppressed people of color and that kept the races different. And I love the opening prayer today, a prayer for unity, a prayer for coming together, systems that keep people apart and that keep some groups down are evil precisely because God loves unity and desires for us, his children, to be unified. And here was Nelson Mandela saying that the reason that that system came down, apartheid, and the reason a new day dawned in South Africa was because of a movement of people from different religious communities and convictions coming together on their shared value of unity, of liberation, of pluralism. And listening to Mandela that day, I thought to myself, how have I not heard about this? How did I not know the important role that this interfaith movement had played in liberating South Africa? I thought to myself, not knowing that means I lack something in my education. This major movement at the end of the 20th century, propelled by people from different faiths working together, to not know that means in some ways I'm not educated. Mandela would go on to be very public and forthright about his friendships with leaders of different faiths. I've got images here of him with the Pope and of him with His Holiness the Dalai Lama. There might well have been times when he consulted with senior leaders of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. There are several Muslims that I know, Ibrahim Rasul, Ibrahim Musa, Farid Esak, in South Africa, who were very close with Mandela, who spoke frequently about his respect for the Muslim faith and what he learned from it. The point is that this major moment in human history was brought about by an interfaith movement. And it changed my eyes. There's a great line by the French writer Marcel Proust that the true journey of discovery is not in seeing new landscapes, it's in developing new eyes. I think that is as good a definition of education as I can think of. Education is the development of new eyes. And that moment with Mandela shaped my eyes about history. I took a different set of eyes in history. And one of the things I started paying attention to was the role that interfaith work, that people from different religious communities and religious convictions coming together in shared values has played in other historical movements. And one of the most inspiring, of course, is one that took place in the United States some 60, 70 years ago. I want to show you an image from the Great March in Selma. And of course, for those of you who pay attention to American public affairs, Selma was in the news a month or two ago because of the death of an American hero, John Lewis. And you'll see there he is, front and center, a young man in his 20s at the time. John Lewis on that bridge from Selma to Montgomery. John Lewis was a deeply convicted Christian. There are great stories about him growing up and preaching to the chickens in the backyard of his parents, where his parents were sharecroppers on a small farm in rural Georgia. And of course, there's the great Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. I frequently call him Reverend King because, as a friend of mine told me some years back, we know a lot about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We know about his speeches and his essays. We know about his intellect, his PhD from Boston University. We don't spend a lot of time on Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. King, the Christian, the man who said that many people want to make of me many things, but in the deep recesses of my heart, I am a Christian minister, a Baptist minister. And my commitment to Jesus as the Son of the Living God is the highest commitment that I have. And of course, there's other figures there in Selma. There's Catholic sisters and Catholic priests. Right behind King, over his left shoulder, there is the great rabbi, Abraham Joshua Heschel, who missed the trains going from Warsaw to Auschwitz by 6 weeks. He could have died in Hitler's hellfires. And instead, there he is in Selma, a great Jewish rabbi, noting later that although the way that Martin Luther King Jr. and I believe our doctrine is different, in Selma, in that interfaith movement to liberate America from its racist history, it felt like worship. And so because of that moment of education that I had with Mandela in South Africa and Cape Town, I took a different set of eyes into history, including into civil rights history. I hail from India, and I'm very interested in the movement that liberated India, the Hind Swaraj movement. And so I began to look into the Hind Swaraj movement. And part of what I discovered is there is a profound interfaith dynamic in that movement as well. And here we have some images of the great Mahatma Gandhi, who is, of course, the beating heart of that movement. And we know that John Lewis and Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. learned a great deal from Gandhi. Gandhi, whose central text wasn't the Bible, although he had deep respect for the Bible, his central text was the Hindu text, the Bhagavad Gita, right? His inspiration came principally from his own tradition of Hinduism. Gandhi passes on a great deal of inspiration to the Christian leadership of the civil rights movement. He himself takes inspiration from people from a range of faiths. There he is with Jawaharlal Nehru, the man with the hat there, who, although is culturally Hindu, is best described religiously as a secular humanist. And there he is with Bhadsha Khan, the tall gentleman next to him with the beard. Bhadsha Khan, the great Muslim leader from Afghanistan, a Pashtun, the same tribe that the Taliban come from, is the tribe that Bhadsha Khan comes from. Often called the Frontier Gandhi, he gets his convictions for interfaith work, for liberation, for pluralism, for nonviolence and peace from Muslim texts. We hear a lot about Gandhi's commitment to ahimsa, nonviolence. Ahimsa is actually a term from a different religion, the religion of Jainism. So here is Gandhi, the great Hindu leader who passes on so much wisdom and inspiration to the Christian leaders of the civil rights movement as they build an interfaith movement. And here is Gandhi taking his inspiration from so many different religions, from Jainism, from the philosophical convictions of ethical humanism, from Islam, with his friendship with Bhadsha Khan. One of the things that I would encourage all of you to do is to consider the moments in history that you find the most inspiring, and to ask the question, were there people from different faiths helping each other in this moment? Were there people from different religions inspiring each other, working together for a common goal, even though they disagreed in doctrine? Did they come together on shared values? Did they accomplish something great together? Did they take inspiration from each other? I actually think one of the most profound questions that we can ask on our way to being educated people is the question, did I get inspired by somebody who believes things that are very different than what I believe? And to illustrate, I want to highlight this image of Dorothy Day, the founder of the Catholic Worker Movement. Here she is in her later years, staring up at police officers in a protest and saying, you should join me in the work towards a peaceful, humane future. We can work on this together. Dorothy Day founded the Catholic Worker Movement. It is a movement that is focused on people living like Jesus lived, not just in service to the poor, but actually with the poor and in solidarity with the poor. They live in houses of hospitality across the country. I was so inspired by Dorothy Day that I spent a summer living in Catholic worker houses. And actually, after I graduated from college, went and spent several months living in a Catholic worker house in Chicago. For me, Dorothy Day is the signal example of somebody whose doctrine I disagree with, but whose values, whose ethics, whose way of life I deeply admire. And I recognize just how much that way of life comes out of her religious conviction. And I realize and have great respect for the audience that I'm speaking to, an audience of people who are committed to mission, who are so committed to their religious convictions that they invite other people into them with generosity and grace. And I actually think that these two things can live side by side. I'm not asking you to give up your commitment to mission. I'm saying to you, alongside your commitment to mission, is there a commitment to neighborliness, to appreciation, to recognition of how other people might be inspired by their religious convictions? If they choose not to accept your invitation, offered with generosity and grace always, to join you in your religious conviction, what might your faith have to say about living as neighbors, about building things together, about working on the terrain of shared values? And think of what it has accomplished in history. Think of the movement against apartheid in South Africa. Think of the civil rights movement in the United States. Think of Hind Swaraj. These movements might never have happened if it had not been for people from different religions coming together on shared values with a shared dream. What I want to do now is show you some snapshots from the America that we live in, an America that is highly religiously diverse and highly religiously devout. I've thus far been showing you snapshots of history, but we very much live in a moment in which an interfaith movement on shared values towards American renewal needs leaders, leaders like you. So these are members of a Sikh Boy Scout troop. It's interesting, right, to think that the Boy Scouts have been a civic institution that people from a whole range of religious communities have found fulfilling and nurturing. And I know about the long-standing relationship between the LDS community and the Boy Scouts, at least historically. My own religious community, Ismaili Muslims, have greatly benefited from this. What if an LDS Boy Scout group found themselves on a camping trip with a Sikh Boy Scout group? What if members of a Boy Scout group are religiously diverse and committed, and those two young men walked into your Boy Scout group and they had a little knife at their side? Would you know that that knife is an article of their faith, a kirpan, which means mercy and bless? what would it mean to be educated about the religious diversity of a Boy Scout or a Girl Scout troop? Right? These are snapshots of religious diversity in American life that you will undoubtedly encounter. Here's another image. So this is an image of American healthcare. And I want you to think about the various people who, the various religious traditions that could well be represented here. That gentleman there is a member of my religious community. He's an Ismaili Muslim. He goes to the same Jamaat Khana that I do. And those other medical professionals, those doctors, those nurses, those respiratory therapists, those custodians who are sanitizing rooms, they're Jehovah's Witnesses. They're Methodists, they're Baptists, they're Catholics, they're Muslims, they're Jews. Actually, American healthcare is probably the single best example of religious diversity coming together in interfaith cooperation for a shared value, which is healing. And it's interesting, right? Because I imagine those of you in the audience who are considering becoming doctors or nurses or respiratory therapists yourself, it is in part your Latter-day Saint conviction that is inspiring you to become a healer. Well, it's the same for the Hindus and Jews and Baha'is and Buddhists and Jains who are doctors and nurses and respiratory therapists. It is their religious conviction that in part inspires them to become a healer. And so when you are all working together to address a particularly acute case of COVID or an acute case of cancer, you are inspired by diverse religious convictions for a profound common cause, which is healing and life. Let's pay attention to the inspiring interfaith cooperation happening in American healthcare. And that cooperation actually goes around the world. So this is one of my favorite images from this past spring and summer, challenging as it has been with an economic recession, with, of course, the COVID crisis, with really deep polarization and a rising ugliness in civic life. Here's this beautiful moment in Jerusalem of a Muslim and a Jew doing their afternoon prayers together, pausing as they make visits to people who are afflicted by ailment or disease, in many cases, the coronavirus. And that van, you'll see, they are part of a medical service in Jerusalem that is funded by an American charity, right? This is such a beautiful image. Can you see yourself as a future doctor or a nurse or driver of an ambulance who pauses to do your prayers alongside somebody who's Hindu or Catholic or Jain or Muslim or a secular humanist who is pausing for his or her moment of reflection? Both of you healers, both of you inspired by your faith conviction, different as it is, to come together and be a healer. And for you to be, consider yourself an educated person in that scene, what would you have to know about that other person's religion? What would you feel like it was required of you to understand about that Jew or that Muslim that you were in that ambulance with or in that operating room with? American healthcare, the way it operates here in the United States and also around the world, an inspiring example of interfaith cooperation. So this is a homeless shelter, Catholic Charities. Catholic Charities is, in many communities around the country, the largest non-governmental charity system. They do adoption services, they do foster care, they do homeless shelters and soup kitchens. I sometimes think to myself, if all of the Catholic institutions shut down in any particular neighborhood, this is probably not the case in Provo or Salt Lake, but it's the case in a lot of places. Here in Chicago, for sure, if all of the Catholic schools, all the Catholic universities, all the Catholic hospitals, all the Catholic social service agencies shut down, you would have very little civic and social service life left. That is how much work Catholic health, social service, educational, civic organizations do in American life. This is a disaster relief service founded by a faith community. And there is a hurricane that is hit Mexico and it's heading for the Gulf Coast in the United States. And God willing, it doesn't cause much damage in Mexico or on the Gulf Coast. And whatever damage it causes, the people who will be helping folks after that damage are people of faith. Southern Baptists run amongst the largest disaster relief services in the United States. If you are involved in disaster relief, either through an LDS effort or through the Red Cross or through a government, I promise you, you will be working with Hindu and Muslim and Catholic and Methodist and Southern Baptist volunteers and organizations in that. Disaster relief in the United States and far beyond is very often an interfaith endeavor. And for you to be educated, to be competent, if you are involved in that, you will have to have an appreciative understanding of the inspiration of other people's faiths and bringing them to that same cause of disaster relief, in this case, that you're involved in. So this next image, this is an image of a Hindu working in a soup kitchen. And I grew up with lots of Hindu friends, in part because I'm South Asian, and those are in some of the communities that I would roll in. And that commitment, the Hindu commitment to helping others, was something that always inspired me. Gandhi would call his movement in India Satyagraha, love force or peace force. The term that I grew up saying all the time was the term seva, service. It's a central part of the Hindu commitment. And you will find Hindu volunteers at food banks across the country. You'll find them setting up their own soup kitchens. And again, I want you to ask the question, if you're part of an LDS group that is volunteering at a food bank or volunteering at a soup kitchen, and you find yourself volunteering alongside a Hindu group, what would you know about their religion? What would you feel like you needed to know in order to be educated? Wouldn't it be wonderful to say to them, you know, I learned in a class at Brigham Young University about the deep Hindu commitment to service. And I want to tell you, I admire it. And it actually has a resonance with my own LDS commitment to service. And I'd love to share some of the similarities and differences here. You know, what a wonderful conversation to be able to engage in. And it's frankly a conversation that has the mark of being educated, right? To understand the inspiration in a different tradition is part of the mark of being educated. Another image. This is an image of a Jew involved in food banking for a cause. There's a great line in Judaism, tikkun olam, to repair the world. And my Jewish friends talk about tikkun olam in any of the causes that they're involved in. So again, I want you to imagine some of the causes you might feel strongly about and where you might encounter Jews alongside you. And wouldn't it be wonderful to lean over to them and to say, hey, you know, I learned in a class at Brigham Young University about tikkun olam, repairing the world. Can you tell me more about that? You know, think about when somebody know something appreciative about your religion, and they talk about, oh, you know, I had friends growing up who were Latter-day Saint, and I was so struck by the commitment to family within the Latter-day Saint community. You know, think about how you feel when somebody knows something appreciative about your community and tradition, even if they don't agree with all the doctrine. Right? They say, you know, I know how one of my best friends was inspired by the Book of Mormon. It helped bring meaning to her life. To be able to do that for somebody else's religion is part of the mark, I think, of being educated. This next image here is an image of an African-American Muslim working at a soup kitchen. And, you know, every night during our evening prayers, I read a Quran verse to my kids, and we discuss that Quran verse. And over again, the Quran says, believe in God and do righteous deeds, and God will welcome you into his mercy. I imagine that there's many parts of LDS scripture that effectively say the same thing. Right? Mercy is such a central element in Islam, the tradition of primacy in Islam. The first teaching that classical Muslim scholars passed on to their students was the one in heaven is merciful. And if you are merciful to those on earth, he will be merciful to you. There's a beautiful line of the Quran. God sent you as nothing but a special mercy upon all the worlds. Rahmatul Alameen is the Arabic. Again, imagine yourself serving next to a Muslim somewhere and being able to say, you know, I know something about mercy in Islam, and it inspired me and it reminded me of some things in my own tradition. Can you tell me more about that? That initial appreciation is the mark of being an educated person. And so is the ability to ask the question afterwards. Nobody's asking you to be an expert on this. I'm only asking you to have a little bit of appreciative knowledge such that you can show your admiration for another tradition and community and ask the kind of question that would elicit a positive and civil conversation. Boy, does this nation need positive and civil conversations between people from different identities. Next image. So these are African-American pastors who are leading a protest outside of a prison. And for any of you who have been paying attention to how racism works in America, you know full well that slavery evolves into Jim Crow segregation, which evolves into mass incarceration. And that is a central reason for the long overdue racial reckoning that we had in the United States this summer. And a lot of it has to do with the fact that we have the largest prison population in the industrialized world, and it principally incarcerates people of color. There are schools and neighborhoods in America where there is a metaphorical train running from that high school to a prison. And it is a new form of Jim Crow or slavery, according to lots of deeply insightful writers and intellectuals and scholars. And in many cases, it is the Black church leaders who've said, this is inhumane. This is wrong. This is a system that is based on sin. We have to be able to do something other than punish people. One of the great leaders of this is the great Bryan Stevenson. And he bases so much of his work at the Equal Justice Initiative on his Christian convictions. And he says, you know, imagine if somebody came into church and said, oh, you did something wrong. We can't accept you here. You can't be a member of this community. We're going to put you over there behind some bars and some barbed wire. And if you say anything about it, we're going to throw you in this inhumane thing called solitary confinement. Bryan Stevenson says, Christian faith doesn't work that way. Christian faith has a whole process of welcoming people back into the community, doing something other than punishment, doing something called restoration, rehabilitation, right? Reconciliation. That is what so many of our faith communities are built on, the conviction that people who have done something wrong can be rehabilitated. They can confess. They can be brought back into the community. Entire churches are based on that. Shouldn't we have a system that is undergirded by those same Christian values? Those same, I would say, interfaith values? There's certainly a process for that in Islam. What if we cast out every sinner in our community and put them behind barbed wire? Terrible situation for faith communities. A terrible situation also for our nation. It is an interfaith movement that is leading this, leading that process of rehabilitation with Black church leaders out front. So back to the Sikh community. This is the Sikh community showing up in defense of the Jewish community that has experienced an awful lot of extremist violence directed to it. And you know, one of my favorite parts of the Sikh tradition is an ethic called Chardi Kala, which is joy in the face of suffering. And everywhere I turn, when another community is suffering, there are members of the Sikh community coming with their ethic of Chardi Kala, joy in the face of suffering, saying, we are with you. We have solidarity with you. We are going to collectively be a community of joy in the face of this suffering. And that's what these Sikh gentlemen are doing here, Chardi Kala. So I want to now turn to something of a different part of this talk. All of these are snapshots of a highly religiously diverse America. In fact, in America that some scholars say is the most religiously diverse nation in human history and probably the most religiously devout nation in the Western Hemisphere. And it's not getting any less religiously diverse. And I've got some numbers here to show you. Right now, there's about 4 million Muslims living in the United States. That number is set to double over the course of the next couple of decades. And what that means is that if you volunteer at soup kitchens or at homeless shelters, or if you're part of Boy Scout troops or part of American civic or professional life in any sort of way, you are likely to be there operating alongside a Muslim physician or working alongside a Muslim engineer or designing a house alongside a Muslim architect. The Muslim population is dramatically growing. So is the Hindu population, and so is the Buddhist population. Let me give you some kind of parallel numbers here. So there's 4 million Muslims in the United States, approximately 4 million. That's about the same number as there are ELCA Lutherans. And it's about twice as many as members of the Episcopal Church, and almost as many Jews and Methodists. So there's about 6 million Jews and Methodists, about 4 million Muslims. And Muslims are a much younger population, right? It is much more likely that if you're 19 years old, you know a Muslim than you know an Episcopalian, frankly. It's a little different if you're 60 years old, but if you're 19, it's more likely you know a Muslim than you know an Episcopalian. And so I want you to again think back to the snapshots of religiously diverse America. And I want you to think just how common it is that you are going to be alongside a Muslim or a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Sikh or a Baha'i or a secular humanist in civic and professional life. And ask you the question, what is it that you would want to know about their tradition in order to be a good doctor, a good professional in disaster relief, a good coach, a good teacher? What is it that you think you want to know to consider yourself an educated person to be part of civic and professional life alongside people from different religions in this, the most religiously diverse nation in human history? A couple of final charts. My organization, Interfaith Youth Corps, we work largely in American higher education, and we just completed what is probably the most ambitious survey of religious diversity in higher education that's ever been done. 120 campuses, over 20,000 students, 3 administrations. We asked students a whole set of questions about religious diversity and diversity in politics more broadly. And here's one of our most striking findings, that 70% of students say that bridging religious divides is really important. Imagine that if you were part of this survey, you might've said the same thing. I think that, you know, the polarization between religious communities is a problem. It's a problem for America. It's a problem for the world. It's a problem for my religion. My religion preaches cooperation and a type of unity. So 70% of you say that that's important to bridge religious divides, but not that many people actually take part in a program that would help you develop the skills and the knowledge to do that, which of course, my speaking at BYU is in part helped to address. So look at these numbers. Only 26% take a course that deals with religious diversity. Fewer than 15% participate in an interfaith dialogue or an interfaith diversity training or an interfaith action. So there's a big gap between the ideal here, the ethic of bridging religious divides, and the actual skills and knowledge to do it. That's a problem. I actually think for a university like Brigham Young, for a community like the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, this is a wonderful opportunity. What if your university, your religious community said, you know, we are going to not just talk about the ideal, we are going to achieve the ideal. We are going to become the ideal. Our students, our community is not only going to be committed to mission, totally legitimate conviction as you do it, offered with generosity and grace, we're also going to be committed to appreciation, to cooperation, to interfaith leadership. We are going to make sure that we have the ability to bridge religious divides. It's one of the most important problems in the world today. We discovered that American higher education does a pretty good job of talking about various forms of diversity. So you look at the blue bars there. Colleges do a good job, by and large, of engaging people in conversations about race and ethnicity, about nationality, about various forms of gender and sexuality, about people from different politics. Over 50% of college students say that those issues are addressed, that there's dedicated time to learning about those things, over 60%, frankly. But I want you to look at the orange there. Fewer than 50% of college students say they spend any time dedicated to religious diversity at all. And frankly, my eye goes straight to the last bar of this chart, the bar that represents Latter-day Saints. And I think to myself just how deeply my life has been enriched by my knowledge of the Latter-day Saints tradition, by my friendships with members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The fact that I know about the LDS commitment to family, the fact that I know about the LDS commitment to community, the fact that when two of my LDS friends are talking and they mention the term ward, I know what they are talking about. I know what they are talking about. I think that the people who do not receive some appreciative knowledge of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, of your ethics, of your history, of the movement west, right, from the Burned Oak District in New York State through Nauvoo all the way into Utah and what it meant, what that journey meant, I think that they're missing something. I think that they lack something in their education. And everywhere I go, whether it's Notre Dame or Harvard or Stanford, I point that out. I say that it is part of being an educated person to have an appreciative knowledge, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Just as I say to you, it is part of being an educated person for members in good standing of the community that is Brigham Young University to have an appreciative knowledge of people from other religions, what inspires them to do things that we all admire, to have an understanding of the history of interfaith cooperation, to have the skills and the vision and the commitment and knowledge base to bridge religious divides. Because, and I'll show my last slide here. This is images of America, of an American ideal, right? And the faded one there is a Norman Rockwell image of religious diversity. And the one alongside it is a bit of a more colorful image. But part of what I want to point out is it has long been an ideal of the United States to be a religiously diverse democracy. All the world is in America, John Locke, the great philosopher, would say. And this is the first nation to believe that you could have people who spoke different languages, who prayed to God in different ways, including not at all, who came from the four corners of the earth to this patch of land and built out of it a nation, aspiring to ideals, even though there have been mistakes and even sins along the way in violation of the ideals of freedom, of cooperation, of pluralism, of dignity for all. We can still achieve that. We can still achieve that. And I think you, students and faculty and staff and administrators at Brigham Young University, can be in the front of that movement. Thank you so much for having me. Jazakallahu khair. May God give you goodness.
Eboo, thank you for joining us today with that stimulating talk and reminder of the role of education in helping us to understand one another's commitments and covenants, but also the blessings that come to us as a community for joining together and building on a set of shared values. We are so grateful for that wonderful address, and I look forward to having you experience some question and answer with our amazing students. Spencer Magleby will lead that, but before we do that, we would like to have Dr. Andrew Reed offer a closing prayer.
Our Father in heaven, we are grateful to have heard Dr. Eboo Patel speak today for his words of encouragement and guidance as we seek to understand appreciate and celebrate the diversity that comes from thee. We're grateful for that diversity, and we pray that we might develop appreciative knowledge that will be useful in our interactions with individuals throughout the world. We pray that as we are seeking education here at Brigham Young University, that though we see many landscapes, we may develop new eyes and find ways to see more clearly the work thou hast for us. We pray thou would bless Dr. Patel and his work in the United States and at universities and throughout the world, that it will be expanded and enlarged by thy great blessings. We pray for the students of this university, that they will hear the messages that are offered through speakers like Dr. Patel and others, that they will be able to embrace those messages and incorporate them into their life of faith and their life of the intellect. We are grateful for the blessings we enjoy here at this university, for the generous donations that make this a place of higher education that is available to many students here throughout that come from the world. We pray for each one of them that they will be blessed during this difficult time and during this semester. And these blessings we pray for and do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The question and answer session with Dr. Patel can be seen right now on the BYU TV app.
Thank you for that excellent presentation. So inspiring. Made me reflect on the things that I do and what I study and learn. So, Dr. Patel, that was fantastic. So I'm Spencer Magleby. I'm one of the associate deans for undergraduate education at the university and the director of the honors program. It's a privilege to be here this morning. Speakers such as Dr. Patel provide a valuable broadening experience for our students. And this breadth and the connections that it provides is especially important to our general education mission. And I appreciate your talk today. So fantastic for our students. So we're looking forward for a chance for Dr. Patel to address questions from the students in our audience. And I appreciate you coming this morning here to the Marriott Center to do that. This part of the forum is a great chance to link the presentation to our students. And it will be available for viewing along with the presentation. Ms. Vika Filimoyatu, my colleague in the honors program, will help queue up students for questions. So if you have a question here, you can come up here by Vika, and we'll line you up here at the microphone. So I'd ask the students if you'd introduce yourself and tell us what you're studying, and then ask a brief and focused question. And then Dr. Patel, we'll turn the time to you to answer those. We probably have time for a dozen-ish or so questions.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you, Dr. Patel, for that inspiring message. My name is Nick Cainsworth. I'm a Middle Eastern Studies, Arabic, and Sociology double major, and one of the co-presidents of the BYU Interfaith Club since January of 2019. And I think one of the largest needs that I've seen during my time doing interfaith at BYU is the need for dialogue between Latter-day Saints and those who used to identify as Latter-day Saints but have distanced themselves from the faith tradition in either belief or practice. So there's a shared Latter-day Saint identity, but oftentimes that orientation is so different that it causes lots of tension and hurt feelings. And so I'm just curious, I'm sorry for the specificity of this question, but if you have any advice or words of wisdom or experience on how to do this kind of interfaith dialogue within a faith tradition where you can both respect and honor each other, even though your convictions around a certain set of beliefs are very, very different.
Yeah. That's a great question. Thank you for that, Nick. And I love your shirt. I just want to tell you how grateful I am for your leadership in interfaith work. I'm really inspired by that. Thank you so much for being one of the students who has acquired the knowledge base and skill set of interfaith leadership. And you pose a very challenging question. And of course, you know, as an Ismaili Muslim, there are differences within my small faith community to Ismaili Muslims and differences within Muslims and more observant and less observant Muslims and people who have a foot within the circle of the tradition and a foot outside of it. So I have some, I certainly have a reference point for your question. And let me just say it should not surprise any of us that arguments within circles of within communities are more heated often than discussions between communities, right? When I come into an LDS setting, I am not surprised by the differences. I expect differences, right? When I deal with a fellow Muslim or a fellow South Asian, I expect not just similarity, but sometimes uniformity. You know, that is not a reasonable expectation, but it's a human expectation, and humans are not just are often unreasonable creatures. So the first thing that I would do is go through some kind of techniques of bridge building in your head. Prepare yourself for the conversation. If you were meeting with a Muslim instead of somebody who has chosen to be less involved in LDS circles, what question would you might you ask that Muslim, right? Is there an appreciative question you would ask that Muslim that you might ask that person who is formerly a member of the LDS community? Something like, you know, is there something about the tradition that inspires you that you could share with me, right? As much as possible, you are kind of divesting yourself of judgment, and you're not leading with the division. You're leading with pluralism. It's a term we use a lot at IFYC. Lead with pluralism. Lead with the question or the story that is likely to build a bridge. And once you've built that bridge, which of course is as very much a bridge of trust, you can begin to probe the more sensitive areas, but lead with pluralism. Ask the appreciative question, right? Let me put it this way. There's no good answer to when you say to somebody, when did you stop kicking your dog? There's no good answer to that question, right? So if you lead with a question that automatically divides, you're not gonna get very far. Lead with pluralism.
Dr. Patel, thank you so much for your inspiring message. My name is Brady Early. I am studying economics and American studies here at BYU. And my question really goes to a lot of what you were talking about at the beginning of your presentation with the great interfaith efforts that have been a part of so many of the inspiring changes that we've seen. And I wanted to ask what you think the role interfaith work can play in the contemporary debates surrounding religious freedom in the United States.
So that's such a great question. And I think thank you for that, Brady. And I think one of the most inspiring things that we can do is to stand up for another religious community's freedom, even when we don't agree with it. Now, I think that there are limits to this, right? So there is so much in common. There is so much in common. I believe that the LDS community ought to have the freedom for a generous preaching of your tradition with grace to other people, right? And I will stand up for that. And if there is a mosque being built in rural Tennessee, you know, Murfreesboro, for example, this was about a decade ago, that people are opposing because they're spreading scandalous lies about Muslims being violent, I would really hope that the LDS community showed up and said, they have, first of all, we know some things about Islam and Muslims. We understand it as a tradition of mercy. We understand it as a religion of people who seek to be contributing citizens. And beyond that, they are given the right of religious freedom, which means the ability to build a house of worship without people frothing and screaming hateful epithets in their face. So I think that we can stand up for each other's religious freedom, and it is a wonderful place to begin interfaith partnerships. That I am committed to the LDS community flourishing and thriving. And I know, because I know from personal experience, the way that the LDS community is committed to my community's flourishing and thriving.
Thank you.
Hi, Eboo. My name is Lauren Craner. I'm studying exercise science and athletic training here at BYU.
Hi, Lauren.
Hi. I'm also a member of the co-president of the Interfaith Club here at BYU. And I just wanted to go back to something that you referenced today in your address to us. You referenced a system based on sin. And I found this really interesting, especially because my question for you today is how do we not only prepare for, but how do we create a religiously diverse democracy in America today?
So, Lauren, first of all, thank you for your leadership and interfaith work. I'm very grateful for it, and I'm inspired by it. So connect the two parts of your question. Mm-hmm. Connect the system based on sin, as I said, as you referenced, and the religiously diverse democracy part.
I'm mainly talking about, so when you referenced a system based on sin, you talked a lot about Bryan Stevenson, who talks a lot about, in all of his work, the importance of proximity. So the importance of being close to not only people involved in that, but the idea in general. So my question of like creating a religiously diverse democracy, how can proximity to diversity help us in creating and preparing others and ourselves for an America that stresses the importance of proximity, stresses the importance of religious diversity and celebrates it.
Yeah. So there's a lot going on in what you're saying, Laura. There's a lot going on. You will not have a choice except to be proximate to people who are different from you. Right? If you go anywhere but a few square blocks of, you know, if you go virtually anywhere in the United States, you will encounter, you have already encountered, but you will only encounter more people from a range of religious traditions. I want you to think about the doctor who delivered you, right? I want you to think about the nurses in that room. I want you to think about the teachers who taught you, the teachers you will teach with if you become a teacher, right? The soldiers you will serve with if you go into the military. You will have no choice except to be proximate to diversity, in part because you are a religious minority. And so unless you leave the beautiful confines of Brigham Young University, in which, by the way, there are several hundred wonderful students who are not members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. But if outside of a few areas in your life, you're going to be proximate to diversity. And I think the question is, will you be the type of educated person who has an appreciative knowledge of the people around you? Right. So when a Muslim says, looks at it when a sound, an Arabic chant emerges from the iPhone of your Muslim physician, and that physician says, I need 5 minutes, you can say to her, are you going for afternoon prayers? and smile, right? Because you've heard of this thing called the Adhan, the Muslim call to prayer, and you know that observant Muslims pray five times a day, and that's a piece of appreciative knowledge you have about that person's tradition, right? These are, I think, part of what it means to be an educated person in proximity to diversity. Lauren, on the part of your question about Bryan Stevenson, you know, my encouragement there is to just, you know, watch the HBO documentary on him, right? Which is not the film Just Mercy, which is also great, but that's a Hollywood film. Pay attention to how deeply Bryan Stevenson's work is undergirded, not just by an abstract faith commitment, but by the structured rituals of his Christian tradition. The ritual of truth-telling, of confession, the ritual of reconciliation and rehabilitation, right? Just how deeply his work is undergirded by that. And I think you get a sense of how somebody who is willing to confront the sin of American racism. This nation enslaved people for hundreds of years and then segregated them and now mass incarcerates them. It is a sin, not just a crime, it is a sin. And here is a man whose faith, conviction, and community is helping him create a process that moves this nation forward in confronting that sin and restoring itself afterward. I find that remarkably inspiring. I find that a profound positive challenge to my Muslim faith and how I as a Muslim and other Muslims might be doing the same, ought to be doing the same.
Thank you so much.
Hello, Dr. Patel. My name is George Garcia. I'm majoring in economics and math. My question deals a little bit more with, or deals with the effective altruism movement, which is largely out of your alma mater of Oxford. It has as a maxim that we have a moral obligation to do the most good we can, which is usually interpreted as doing what we can to efficiently and effectively increase well-being in all sentient creatures. There is as of yet no consensus on how to do the most good. Some have argued for a focus on existential risk management, others for global poverty alleviation, yet others for combating the horrid practices of factory farming. But I've never heard of an argument for including interfaith work as a cause area within effective altruism. And so my question for you is, to what extent do you believe that interfaith work should be considered as a cause area or as a way of doing the most good we can?
George, I've been doing this work for 20 years and I have never heard that question. I've heard some version of other questions 1,000 times. I've never heard, what's the technical phrase? Effective altruism?
Yeah, that's right.
Is that a phrase out of economics?
No, it's a phrase, it's a movement. Effective altruism, it comes largely from the philosophy of Peter Singer, as well as other philosophers that mostly come out of Oxford, like William McCaskill and Toby Ord.
Okay. Well, I'm a little bit more educated having heard that question. So thank you for, I was meant to give a talk on education, and part of the best part of my job is to hear the inspiration that the other interfaith leaders in the audience offer through their questions and to learn a little something from the question you asked. So thank you for that. I absolutely think that figuring out ways to partner across lines of difference and division, which of course religious communities are and long have been, has got to be at the center of any movement of effective altruism, right? Because first of all, there's a multiplier effect in terms of increasing social capital, strengthening the civic fabric, reducing social harms like prejudice when people from different religions partner together. So there's a lot of upside good. But when people from different religions don't partner together and they're either in isolation or worse in conflict, there's a lot of downside bad. Right? Like there's lots and lots of bad things that happen in the world when people from different religions are at each other's throats. So part of the reason I love interfaith work is there's an awful lot of good we can achieve and there's an awful lot of bad that we can mitigate. So I think any movement of effective altruism ought to be considering the various ways that people who orient around religion differently can work together for the common good as absolutely central. And of course, there's different philosophical understandings of the common good, but I might say it in more experiential terms. What does it mean to build a common life together? What does it mean to build a common life together? And the earlier question about religious freedom, I think, is a part of that, right? So you have the right to, and not just the right, but I believe it is a beautiful thing when members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints get to be themselves, right, in flourishing and thriving. And I believe it's a beautiful thing when Muslims and Catholics and Methodists and secular humanists and Jains and Buddhists and Baha'is get to be the same. And I think that we are each other's protectors and partners in that endeavor.
My name is Marin Fitzsimmons. I'm studying marketing here at BYU. I'm also co-president of the Catholic Newman Club. So my question is about if you have a conflict or after like a protest, what's the best way to reteach connection and honor that voice that's been shared in an effective way?
What a great question. Was it Marin you said your name was?
Yes. Yeah, Marin.
Okay, great. So give me another 30 seconds or so on that question.
Yeah.
Give me a little bit of texture.
So I just feel like right now it's a pretty divisive time in terms of people having a lot of different interests or things that they're looking to gain. So how can we reconcile after a conflict or something of that nature? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's a great, so this is a molten moment. This is a molten moment in American life, in global life, and things are changing so fast, right? And it is a time when a different world can be built, when different institutions can be built, when different ideas have the chance to become reality. So, you know, 20 years ago, around the terrible events of 9/11 was another molten moment. And what's one of the things about my own story is that IFYC, I actually founded IFYC in 1998, in June of 1998, and nobody paid that much attention to it. Nobody thought that engaging young people from different religious backgrounds in positive social action and interfaith dialogue was an idea worth giving attention to. And then 9/11 happens, and all of a sudden, lots of people are paying attention to young people and religious diversity and positive social action. And so, you know, an organization that people rolled their eyes at when I talked about it for 3 whole years, it's a long time when you're 22 years old and trying to get something off the ground. All of a sudden, you know, the Ford Foundation makes a grant and the Chicago Community Trust makes a grant and people like David Gergen start paying attention, et cetera, et cetera. It was a molten moment, right? And this is a molten moment where we need to not just decry what is wrong, but build what is right. So what does it look like to build something better? What does it look like to build something better? And I have to say that I come out of college a critic. I had a kind of a deep education in critical theory when I was an undergrad. And I was very good at telling people what was wrong. And the kind of founding moment, the origin story of IFYC is me being at an interfaith conference at Stanford University in June of 1998. I was 22 years old. And, you know, it was a fancy event with lots of older people and mostly male theologians speaking on panels. And I got up from the floor and I raised my fist and I pointed my finger and I said, you know, this is too boring and it's too old and it's too white and it's too male and it's, you know, it's not exciting enough. Where's the diversity? Where's the edginess? Where's the young people? You know, where's the feeling of the great energetic social movements? And somebody came up to me and said, you know, that's a major point that you're offering. You know, this idea of an interfaith movement of young people, different religions, social action, you should build that, right? And I think that this is one of those moments. There is a sense that there are lots of things around us that are not, there are lots of institutions and patterns of being that are not up to the challenges that we face, to a majority-minority nation, the coming majority-minority nation, to the challenges that range from political division to a warming climate. It is not enough to tell people what's going wrong. You have to have the skill set, the vision, the knowledge base, the commitment to build things that are right.
Thank you.
Hi, Eboo. Thanks so much for your talk. My name is Elizabeth Wallace. I'm a comparative literature student. And my question is about secularism and like secularization. I know that within the history of the United States, there was this thought of, oh, the U.S. is Christian. And then increasingly there's a move towards secularization, which I think has benefits for non-Christian religions. But I wondered if you could speak a little bit about the pros and cons of secularization when it has to do with like how it's impacted conversations between and about different faiths.
Yeah, man, these questions, I'll tell you, you people at Brigham Young University, you do an awful lot right on all kinds of things and including intellectual matters. I mean, these are, you know, amongst the best set of questions I've ever gotten at any university, and I've been at a lot. So thank you for just the seriousness with which you take these issues. So the term secular or secularization means lots and lots of different things. Who is it? Was it Charles Taylor who wrote a 700-page book on this, right? It is impossible to get into all of the different distinctions of this right now. Maybe I'll just highlight for a minute the work of Peter Berger, who's a sociologist who died a couple of years ago, who had a major influence on me. He wrote books like A Rumor of Angels and The Sacred Canopy. And in the 1960s, he was a proponent of something called the secularization thesis, which is basically when societies modernize, they naturally secularize, right? And he was basically looking at the European experience in this, and that just was not true in the United States. It doesn't mean that we have not had a larger a growth in the population of people who would call themselves non-religious or secular humanist. We have had a dramatic growth in that. If you look at research from Pew or the Public Religion Research Institute or Robert Putnam, for example, a dramatic growth in that. But American society has remained suffused with religious language and religious symbols. And so the society as a whole would be hard to say we've secularized, particularly if you look at the role of religious language in political parties, right? What it has done, and Peter Berger said this, I don't know, 10 or 15 years ago, he kind of altered his thesis. He said, we made a category mistake. America, when it modernized, it didn't secularize, it diversified. And by diversity, I don't just mean Mormons and Muslims. I also mean many ways of being Muslim and probably also many ways of being a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, right? Modernization fragments, it diversifies. And that leads to a great deal of complexity, if you look at the media environment, right, you know, what was it 20 years ago that Bruce Springsteen or 30 years ago wrote 57 channels and nothing on? 57 channels was supposed to suggest, like metaphorically, a number, you know, a high number. I mean, what do we have now? 5,700 channels, right? There's no kind of center to American kind of reasoned, there's no center to American public discourse anymore in the way that Walter Cronkite, at least for white Americans, could have been considered a center 60 some years ago, right? There's some good things to that because because, I mean, let's be honest, there were the people at the center were people from a particular ethnic, religious, gender group. And when you're at the center, it means other people are at least a little bit on the margins. So in the dramatic complexity of American diversity as a result of modernity, right? Again, I'm saying I'm following Peter Berger's revisions here. Modernity doesn't lead to secularization; it leads to diversification, right? Which oftentimes is a close cousin of fragmentation. What does it look like to build kind of a coherent and positive pluralism in this moment? I think it is very, very challenging to do. And all of your questions have pointed to that, right? Questions about effective altruism, questions about facing up to American sins and how to do that, questions about how to engage people who view themselves as having departed from the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. These are challenges these are 2020 challenges in a way that they were not year 1990 challenges. And one of the reasons I love talking to young people is because you're willing to look these challenges in the eye and say, we got to deal with them. We got to deal with this, right? We can't hide. Can't put our heads in the sand. We got to deal with this. When a challenge isn't confronted, it grows. You got to deal with it.
Thank you so much.
Hi. First, I would like to thank you for giving this wonderful speech. Salaamu alaikum. My name is Noor. Yes. And I'm a Muslim from Palestine, and I study computer science at Brigham Young University. So my question is, I grew up in a Muslim-dominated community, and there's this belief that our religion is the only right path for happiness in the afterlife. And when I came to BYU, I've seen this exact same pattern where people strongly believe like that their religion is the only right way for happiness. And this concept could be confusing to a lot of people. So I guess my question is, how did you find peace in Islam? And how did that help you find, did it help you understand that different people find peace in different religions?
Oh, Noor, that's such a, you know, your name means light, as you know,
yep.
Right? And in fact, in the Quran readings that I've done with my kids, we read an English translation. We don't read the Quran in Arabic, unfortunately. Inshallah, one day, we came across the verse of light, that God is light upon, is like a lamp in a niche, light upon light. And your name and your question makes me think of that. So, you know, I mean, I wrote, my first book is on this, right? My first book is on how my own spiritual journey. So it's my book, it's a book called Acts of Faith, my own spiritual journey. The fact that when I was in high school, I had a girlfriend who was member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I've had friends from different religions. I came to admire people from different faiths. And I ultimately came back to Islam, right? And I am fully aware that I come back to Islam not principally because I found things in other religions inadequate. It's not like I studied other religions or came into contact with people from other faiths and said, well, there's something missing. It's more like in the course of learning about these different religions, largely through friendships, right? First friendship, followed by admiration, followed by study. What I learned was actually kind of obvious and clear, which is, there are lots of Jews I know who are living full and thriving lives. There's lots of Christians I know whose Christianity inspires them to do remarkable things. And I wanted that. And for me, it was in Islam. And do I think Islam has the fullness of truth? The answer to that is yes. Right? I think it has the fullness of truth. Do I believe that other religious traditions also have great goodness, even truth? Absolutely. And that's not just something that is a kind of an observation of the good people who I know, who principally consider themselves exponents of these traditions. It is within the tradition of Islam to recognize the great goodness and truth that is in other traditions. And so, you know, Quranic phrases like God has sent a teacher to every community. You know, the term ayah, which doesn't just mean verse of the Quran, as you all know, nor it means sign, which means that there are signs for other people to read, right? These are examples of the great goodness and truth in other traditions. I understand for other people, it's challenging. It's not challenging for me, right? It is almost like I think to myself, oh, you know, that oak tree is beautiful. That pine tree is beautiful. This oak tree is in my yard. It has got a different kind of beauty, a larger beauty, a fuller beauty, but that doesn't mean the pine tree is not beautiful, right? I think that my parents are the best parents in the world. I have a lot of respect and appreciation for your parents. Makes sense to me that you think your parents are the best in the world. I'm not going to change my opinion about my parents, but your view makes sense to me. And I'm very happy to appreciate and welcome the goodness that I see in your parents. You see the kind of examples that I'm making? By the way, if this is intellectually or religiously challenging for you, I understand that too. I totally understand that too, right? It doesn't happen to be for me. It doesn't happen to be for me. There's other things that are challenging for me, right? My kids right now they're like extremely challenged by religion and science, you know? So dad, should we believe in religion and science? And I'm like, both. And I'm like, and they're like, what happens when they contradict each other? You know, the earth is created in so many days, or the earth is so many billions of years old. I'm like, you know, like they are different wisdoms. They are different wisdoms. I'm using an illustrative example, right? They are different wisdoms. And mostly I go through the world asking myself the question, are there things that I can appreciate about you? Is there a wisdom that you have that I can learn from?
Thank you so much.
My name is Josie Manuel Heal, and I'm really grateful for your thoughts today. My question is, how do university students and others add their own voice to promote unity and plurality in a very polarized and, well, honestly, just very upsetting and confrontational world?
Yeah. I mean, you know, be a bright spot. Honestly, be a bright spot, right? I have never, American, so character is everything, right? The way, you know, Noor, the term azab, right? Azab, it means like, it's an Arabic term for a manner of decorum, right? And I believe like that is, In Islam, it is the highest value to the manner in which we conduct ourselves, the manner, the way we are with other people, right? And frankly, I have always experienced something very similar around members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The way, I mean, you know, y'all won't let me take a taxi to the airport, you know, seriously. Like every time I come to Salt Lake or Provo, I've probably been to Salt Lake 2-3 times. I've been to Provo twice. Always somebody comes and picks me up. Always somebody comes and drops me off. That's decorum. That is the beautiful way that we are with other people. And I would say, like, you know, who is it, Dostoevsky that says this, that beauty will save the world? So I would say my suggestion to you is be a bright spot, right? Do as much as possible. Don't get involved in the ugliness of the tangle. Be a different way of being. In fact, I think that's like that is the secret of all religions. It is, they are a different way of being. It is a different way of being, right? I don't know what else to say, because I have a sense that everybody in that audience will understand what I'm saying. This is very much kind of the LDS story, right? It's very much the Muslim story. It was in a time of great unrest and ugliness, a different way of being emerged that people found beautiful and were attracted to. I would say be a different way of being.
Thank you.
Thank you for your remarks, Dr. Patel. I'm Tyler Dawes. I'm a family life, family studies major. One thing that stood out to me in your talk was you stated that the journey is not seeing new landscapes, but it is changing our eyes. And my question for you is, what is a challenge that you personally have faced in changing your eyes? And what advice can you give to us to help us better change our eyes to see, I guess, diversity, to see those things more fully?
Yeah, that's a great question. So all of you have great questions. I mean, I'm impressed, I'm moved, I'm challenged, I'm stimulated. Thank you for who you are and your questions and just the intellectual life of Brigham Young University. So I'm part of a Muslim minority community, right? And in many cases, I would imagine the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints might well view itself as a minority community within the world of Christendom. And part of being a minority community is that people who are part of the majority or the mainstream, they view you as heterodox. They view me as heterodox and heretical sometimes. And I think that an interesting challenge is how to have generosity of spirit with people within my own tradition who view my practice of theology as either heterodox or heretical. And can I employ within, when it's very personal, my own advice that I give to other people about interfaith engagement and bridging religious divides when it's personal? And that has continually been a challenge. To the other part of your question, I think the interesting thing is, it is impossible to, I just want you to think about the images that I showed you in my presentation. And I want you to think in your life when you have snapshots from your own memory of diversity. Right. So have you served in a soup kitchen with Muslims or Hindus? Have you been on a trip to the Grand Canyon or to Zion, you know, National Park and seen a group of Sikhs camping? Have you been assigned the reading of a great Jewish sage in your religion classes at Brigham Young University? And when you encounter that difference, what level of appreciation and inquisitiveness do you bring to it? Right. That's what I would encourage when it comes to kind of the changing of eyes.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.